Hello, this is Sabir. The topic of our discussion in this video is limit, rate of change, and tangent line. We will begin this video from the notion of secant line. What is a secant line? Secant line is a line which cross the function, which intersect the function at two point. So here, this is a question of a secant line. This intersect the function at point A and B. How to calculate the slope of the secant line is basically first calculating what is the value of this point and what is the value of this point. Let's suppose if this point is x0 and y value of this point is a y0 and this point is x1 and the y value is y1, then the slope of this secant line, or in other words, a line which passes through these two points, will be a rise over run, how much you have rise. So if you are starting from x0 and you are x1 here, so the total distance you run is x1 minus x0. If you rise from, then this distance is y1 minus y0. So how much is rise? So rise over run. So our rise is y1 minus y0 and run is x1 minus x0. So to calculate the slope of the secant line, the first we have to calculate the point A and B, which lies on the curve where the line intersect the curve. And then we will basically subtract the y values, divide by the difference of the x value. So difference of y value divided by the difference of x value. Here I have one example where we will calculate the slope of the secant line on the interval 1 to 3. So in very first step, so we will divide this problem number into step. In step number one, we will calculate the point where the line intersect the graph of the function. So the interval is 1 to 3. It means the x value is 1 and x value is 3. We have to calculate the y value of the point. So let's suppose this is a point A and this is a point B. So the x value of the point A is the interval where it start, which start at 1, and the y value of the point is where the end point of the interval. So to calculate the y value of the point, you will plug the x value into the function to calculate the y value. So the coordinate of the point A will be 1, comma. If I plug 1 into my function, I will get 0. So one point is 1, comma 0. And the second point is, if I plug 3 in the function, you place x by 3 here, that will be 27 minus 1, so it will be 26. Now, in step number 2, we will calculate the slope of the secant line. So, slope of the secant line is the difference of y value divided by difference of x value. So, difference of y value is 26 minus 0 divided by the difference of x value is 3 minus 1. This will be the slope of the secant line, which is a y minus y value, x minus x value. So this is a 26 divided by 2, which will give you 13. So the slope of our secant line is 13. Now, in step number 3, we will find the equation of the secant line. We know that the equation of any line, the equation of any line can be written as y is equal to slope time y intercept, that is y is equal to mx plus b. But we already know that our slope is 13, so it can be written as 13x plus b. Next is, to calculate point B, we will pick any point. Either we can pick the first point or second point. I will pick the first one and plug that into the equation, because this equation passes through this point. So if I if I take, this is your y value, second point is a y value, and this point is x value. So if I plug y value 0 and x value 1, this gives me b is equal to minus 13. So this is the value of b. Now I have the values of a and b. I can write down the equation of a line. So the equation of the line y is equal to 13x minus 13. So this is our equation of secant line. Let's practice this concept on one more example. Here I have a function f of x is equal to x square plus 1 divided by x plus 2 on the interval 1, 2, 3. So again, we will begin in step number 1. In step number 1, we will calculate how the point where this line passes through. Again, the x value of the point is 1, and the end point of the interval is 3. So x value is 1 and 3. I will plug that x value into the function to calculate the y value. So I will plug that 3 into the function also. If I plug 1 is in place of x, I will get 1 plus 1, this is a 2, and 1 plus 2 is a 3. So that's give me a 2/3. And if I plug 3 into the function, I get 9 plus 1 is a 10. And I get 3 plus 2, which will give me 5. This will be 3 comma 2. So these are my two points. The secant line passes through this point and this point. So to calculate in the step number 2, we will calculate the slope, which is the difference of y value, which is a 2 minus 2/3, divided by the difference of x value, which is a 3 minus 1. 2 minus 2/3 also can be basically making the same denominator, 6 minus 4 divided by 3, and this is whole entire thing is a divided by 2, so which can be simplified to 2 divided by 3 times 2, which is 1/3. So this is our slope of the secant line, which is 1/3. In step number 3, we will calculate the equation of the line, the secant line, which is equal to y is equal to mx plus b. Since m is a 1/3, it's going to be 1/3 x plus b. And I will pick any point, whichever I like. So this time I will pick the second point to calculate my b. Y is 2 when I plug x is equal to 3. So this is going to be a 1 plus b, because if I plug x is equal to 3 here, that 1/3 and 3 will cancel. So I will get only 1. This implies my b is 1 unit. So now I can write down the equation of the secant line, which is equal to y is equal to 1/3 x plus b, which is a 1. Here I have one quiz problem for you guys, for you to practice. Please pause the video for 1 and 2 minutes. And once you solve this problem, so you can leave your answer in the link above to compare your answer with the other audience. The next topic of our discussion is tangent lines. Let's first see what is the definition of tangent line. Tangent line to a curve at a point P is a line that just touches the curve at point P. So near this point P, the tangent line only touches the curve. It will not intersect the curve as we see in the secant line. So the difference between a secant line and a tangent line is tangent line touches the curve and secant line intersects the curve. Here is another equation of a tangent line, but here the tangent line intersects at two points, but the notion of the tangent line is the tangent line touches the point P near P. So as long as near point P the line touches, then it will still will be a tangent line, even though it can intersect the graph at some other point, but not near point P. Here this is also a tangent line, this is another tangent line. So these are all at a different point P, these are all tangent line, because near point P is just touch the graph of the function. In the what is the relation between a tangent line and a secant line? So here you can see that this is a secant line which passes through the point P and Q, and if I run this animation, so we observe a secant line become tangent line when the point Q approaches to P. So the slope of a tangent line is the limit of the slope of a secant line. And we already know that how to calculate the slope of secant lines. So to calculate the slope of the tangent lines, we will calculate the slope of secant lines when the point Q approaches to point P. Let's work on this example. So in step number one, I will calculate the slope of secant lines. In step number one, we will calculate a point 1, because this is a point 1, its y value is given by plugging that 1 into the function, which is a 2. So this is a given also, this is a point P. And I will calculate, I will take a point Q, which is close to 1, but it's away from 1. Let's suppose I take an arbitrary point H, which is near 1. And then to calculate the y values of that point, I will plug that point into the function, which become 2h square. So therefore the slope of a secant line which passes through the point P and a arbitrary point h will be the difference of y value, which is a 2h square minus 2, divided by the difference of x value, which is h and 1. So this will gives me the slope of secant lines which intersect the point P and an arbitrary point Q. Now in step number two, we will calculate the slope of secant lines for a different values of H. So here I will have slope and here I have the values H. Let's start from 2. Then we'll plug 1.5, then maybe 1.1, 1.01. And we can keep getting closer and closer to 1. And we plug these values into this function, which is a 2h square minus 2 divided by h minus 1. So by plugging these values, h is equal to 2, in this function, you will get 6. If I plug h is equal to 1.5, I will get 5. That means this is the slope of the secant line from point from 1, 2 and 1.5 when you plug 1.5 here. And then I plug 1.1, it will be the slope on the interval 1 to 1.1, which is a 4.2. If I plug 1.01, which is a 4.02. And if I plug 1.001, which is a 4.002. As you can see that this point are approaching to 1, which is our point, the original point. It means this slope will approach to the slope of the tangent line, because the slope of the tangent line is the limiting value of the slope of the secant line. So we can conclude the proximate, value of slope of tangent line is 4 units. So we can just guess that it is a 4 units. Now to find the equation of the tangent line. So we will write y is equal to 4x plus b. Since the line passes through 1 comma 4, so 1 comma 2, so y is 2 when x is a 1, so b will give you negative 2. So the slope of the equation of the tangent line is y is equal to 4x minus 2. Now, from this example and the previous discussion, we can define the slope of tangent line. So what will be the slope of tangent line? So basically, if you choose, let's suppose we have the graph of the function y is equal to fx. If you have a point here, a comma f of a, because y value of the point is when you plug the x value in the point, and you want to find the equations of the tangent line at this point. If we pick an arbitrary point, similarly we pick in that example, if we pick that arbitrary point, and suppose the value of that arbitrary point is h, and the y value of this point will be f of h, then we will calculate the slope of this secant line which passes through this point, which will be the difference of y value, which is f of h minus f of a divided by h minus a. And if I take my h, so this is my h value here, if I take my h value closer to a, that will give me the slope of the tangent line. So the slope of the tangent line will be calculated from this quotient, which will be really important in this chapter. As we will see in future, this quotient will appear multiple times. So the definition of the average velocity is the change in the position divided by the time elapsed. So if let's suppose you're from s of t is a displacement function which gives you the displacement. At any time t. If we calculate the slope of a secant line from interval t0 to t1, and let's see that what it will be. So the slope of the secant line on the graph of this function from the interval t is equal to t0 to t1 will be the change in the position, which will be t1 minus s of t0 divided by the change in time t1 minus t0, which is the same as the average velocity. So average velocity is the slope of the secant line on the graph of the displacement function from time t is equal to 0 to t is equal to 1. Instantaneous velocity is the limiting value of the average velocity, or the limiting value of the average velocity over a shorter and shorter period of time. So to calculate the instantaneous velocity, we will calculate the slope of the tangent line, because the slope of the tangent line is the limiting value of the slope of the secant line. So this slope of the secant line will give us the average velocity, and the slope of the tangent line will give us the instantaneous velocity. Let's practice this concept on this example. So we have this real world problem where a ball is thrown into the air, and the displacement of this ball is given by this function p of t is equal to minus 16t squared plus 10t plus 7. In part number A, we will find the average velocity between the times t is equal to 1 to 2. In the part B, we will find the average velocity from the time t is equal to 1 and an arbitrary time t is equal to h. And in part C, we will find the instantaneous velocity, or also is known as the velocity of the ball at t is equal to 1. So part A, to calculate the average velocity, which is same as calculate the slope of the secant line from time t is equal to 1 and 2 on the graph of that function, which is the displacement function. So if I plug 1 into the function, I will calculate the y value by plugging 1 into the graph of the in place of t. So if I plug 1, I will get minus 16 plus 10 plus 7, which is give me minus 16 plus 17, which is a 1. So the point which is lies on the graph of the function is 1 comma 1, and the second point is a 2. To calculate the y value of that point, we will plug that 2 into the function in place of t. So I will get negative 37, because that will be minus 16 times 4, which will be 64. 64 minus 64 plus 27, which will be minus 38. So the average velocity in this case, average velocity is simply the slope of the secant line, which is the difference of the y value, minus 37 minus 1 divided by 2 minus 1. So it is a minus 38. So as you can see, the ball will be dropping from time t is equal to 1 to 2. That's why you have a negative average velocity, because it is a fell. So in the direction of the average velocity is negative. Now calculate the average velocity from the on the interval 1 to h. So we have point 1. When we plug 1 into the function, I will get 1 comma 1. But now we have arbitrary point h, and calculate the y value of the arbitrary point h. I will plug that h into the function. So I will get h minus 16 h square plus 10 h plus 7. That will be my y value. So the average velocity of the ball between 1 to h will be the difference of y value, which is minus 16 h square plus 10 h plus 7, divided by the difference of the x value, which is a x and 1. So therefore, this will be, after simplification, 16 h square plus 10 h plus 6 divided by h minus 1. So this is our average velocity on the interval 1 to h. If I move h closer and closer to 1, this average velocity will give me the instantaneously velocity. So in to calculate part c, we will draw that table. In this table, we will calculate the average velocity here. Average velocity. Here we will take h. So if I take h is equal to 2, that means I'm calculating the average velocity for on the interval 1 to 2. If I take h is equal to 1.5, then I'm calculating the average velocity from 1 to 5. And if I take 1.01, then it will be the average velocity over 1.01. And if I take h is equal to 0.01, so that means the average velocity of 1 over 1.001. So this will be approximate the instantaneous velocity, because instantaneous velocity is defined as the average velocity over a really small interval. So the length of this interval is really small and it is really close to 1. So we know that from the previous part, the average velocity of the on the interval 1 to h is given by minus 16 h square plus 10 h plus 6 divided by h minus 1. So I will plug these values of h to 1.5, 1.01, and 1.001 into this function and calculate the average velocity on these intervals. After plugging all these values, I have this table. So when I plug h is equal to 2, I will get minus 38. If I plug h is equal to 1.5 into the average velocity, I will get the average velocity 30. If I plug h is equal to 1.01, my average velocity on this interval will be minus 22.16. And if I plug 1.2001, the average velocity will be this. So I can conclude the instantaneous velocity of the function will be approximately is equal to minus 22, because these numbers are approaching to minus 22, or even this interval is really, really closed. So the average velocity is equal to the instantaneous velocity over a really small interval. Let's practice this concept on a one more example. Here I have a one real world problem. Again, the problem is the ball is thrown upward with a velocity 40 feet per second. Then the height of the ball in a later second is given by this function. So this is a displacement function of the ball. And we will find the average velocity on these three interval, 0 to 2, 1 to 2, and 1.5 to 2. The average velocity on the interval 0 to 2 is given by this formula. Basically, you plug in your function. So in the function, let's suppose this function is a f of t. So let's suppose our function f of t is a 40t minus 16t square. So you plug f2 minus f0 divided by 2 minus 0. So I will plug 2 into my function and evaluate it, and then I plug 0 and then I evaluate it, and then I take the difference of my x value, which is a 2 to 0. So when I plug 2 into my function, let's see what I get. So if I plug x is equal to 2 into my function, I will get 16. And when I plug 0 into my function, I will get 0. So 16 minus 0 divided by 2, which will give me 8. So the average velocity on the interval 0 to 2 is 8. Next is the average velocity on this interval 1 to 2 will be f evaluated at 2 minus f evaluated at 1 divided by 2 minus 1. If I plug 2 into my function, I will get 16 again. If I plug 1 into my function, I will get 40 minus 16. So it will be, which is 24. And then this is a 2 minus 1 is divided by 1. This times your average velocity is minus 8. Instead of positive 8, it is a negative 8 this time. Now let's calculate the last one, the average velocity on the interval 1.5 to 2, the same as f evaluated at 2 minus f value is 1.5, which is a 3/2 divided by 1.5, the difference of value 2 minus 1.5. Let's plug, this is giving me 16, plugging this, and this is give me 0.5. Let's plug that into the function and see what is the. So after plugging 1.5 into the function, I get 24. So 16 minus 24 is a minus 8. So minus 8 is divided by 0.5, which gives you minus 16. So your average velocity over this interval is 8, negative 8, and minus 16. This is all I have in this video. If you like my video, subscribe my channel and hit the bell button so you can get the next video. In the next video, we will learn about the limits, how to calculate the limit of a given function. Bye for now.